I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Brothers, this is Reverend Satchmo getting ready to beat out this mellow sermon for you. My text this evening is when the saints go marching in. Here come Brother Hickenbottom down the aisle with his trombone. Blow it, boy.
Saints go marching in.
Go ahead, brother. saints
go
marching in,
marching in.
When the saints go marching in,
marching in.
Yes, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in.
You may be seated. First of all, I want to say thank you for being here. I have a lot of mixed feelings about today. Dick and Nancy, it's hard to imagine one without the other. You know, it's interesting how God sometimes puts certain people in your life and it really changes your life. I cannot think about Dick without grinning. I know so many stories on him. Of course, he knows some on me too. And as they say, we're here to celebrate a life. Now that kind of sounds a little bit strange, but I think by the end of the service, you'll understand why we use that term. You know, kind of a lot of mixed feelings. I have a lot of joy in my heart because I know where Dick is and I know that I'm going to see Dick again. And then he's probably already told a lot of stories on me, so I'm not sure if they're going to even let me in, you know. But we're going to talk about Dick Burnett and we're going to share some stories. There's a lot of stories. But then there's another story we're going to share at the end of this thing is the reason that we have hope. And that story is about Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, that makes all the difference in the world today. It really does. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for who you are. Father, in all of your creation, you created this world, and it was just spectacular, all the things you put in this world for us. Father, we know you could have created things in black and white, but we enjoy so many different beautiful colors. Father, there's so many different incredible smells and things that we enjoy. Father, sounds that we love to hear. And Father, we look forward one day to hear Dick one more time tell his corny jokes and just to be able to share those experiences. But Father, we also know that you put people in our lives for your purpose. Father, Dick Burnett was one of those people. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit would bring comfort to this family. Father, there are a lot of mixed feelings. I know there's a lot of hurt and a lot of missing, but there's a lot of joy too because of what we know about Dick and what we know about Jesus Christ. Father, we just pray that you would speak. Father, many times we grasp for words that would bring comfort, but Father, our words fall short. But Father, it's to your word that we turn, and Father, we do find true comfort there. Father, we ask that you would speak to us today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Dick Burnett, Dick slipped into the arms of his master on June the 3rd, 2021. He was born April 10th, 1941 in Seagraves, Texas, to Ray D. and Nerva F. Burnett. He married Nancy Snyder on December 18th, 1960. That's a week or two ago. And with that union lasting 60 years, his parents and two brothers, Wayne and Lloyd, preceded him in death. It began at 12 years of age with his dad in the Burnett Cabinet Shop in Plainview, Texas. In those years, he learned and perfected an enormous talent in woodworking. He worked for several people along the years and had a shop of his own at one time, then finalized his talent with Texas Tech University, retiring in 2007. He was a charter member of Redbud Baptist Church in Lubbock for 40 years, serving in many capacities, including being a deacon, a Sunday school teacher. I think he was the jester, too, here. There were many friends here, plus numerous friends of other phases of his life, many friends with his within his family. Dick was concerned about others, patient and quiet at times, but could also be very happy with a witty personality. Dick is survived by his wife Nancy with 60 years together. He was pop to three sons, Richard Todd and his wife Trina of Indianapolis, Indiana, Robert Ty and his wife Cindy of Lubbock, Texas, Ray Trent and his wife Valerie of El Paso, Texas, all of whom loved him very much. There are six grandchildren: TJ, Haley, Austin, Travis Burnett, Amber Zapata, and Jeremy Frostu. I don't know if I'm saying that right. That's the way I would say it. And five great-grandchildren. He's also survived by his sister, Evelyn Mitchell, and husband, Lonnie of Ferris, Texas, and a daughter-in-law, Donna Burnett of Burleson. There are many nieces and nephews, plus cousins, who were very special to Dick. Our praise now is Dick is at the feet of Jesus and is very content there. Let's take a few moments as God will minister our hearts through a song.
The day when my faith
You know, it's impossible to do justice to a life of Dick Burnett in just the few moments we have, but we've asked the family. I know this is difficult to do, but the boys want to share some memories of their dad. And we're going to take this time right now, and I think they've already decided who's going to go first, but if you'll come at this time.
Thank you for that song. That song always gets me. Thank you for that. Thank you all for coming. Taking a look in the room, Dad touched many hearts. Thank you all for being here. My name is Trent. I'm the youngest of three. And I learned from my brothers what not I could get away with, but Pop was always there to set me straight, always there. He was always very supportive and very encouraging. Whatever we were interested in, whether it be sports or BMX or music. I'm sure Ty and I drove Nanny and Pop crazy practicing our guitars. The volume up loud, but and I also remember Pop setting up a stage in our backyard, and he made us little fake wooden guitars before we actually learned how to play guitar, and we would charge 25 cents for people to come in and watch us air guitaring to the music of Kiss in the background. I'm sure they were there to laugh at us as well. But I mean, Pop, he was, you know, just said he was a very talented woodworker as well. You know, I had fond memories growing up, Saturday mornings working at a shop, cleaning up sawdust, and when we had some spare time, we'd get to play around on the saws, cutting up different wood, and I've got furniture at home that he had made, and it's priceless to me. Cherish it for the rest of my life. He's also very passionate about leading people to Christ and spreading the word. Church was very important growing up. We grew up in this church. It's changed a little bit, but it's this church means a lot to me. My Pop actually baptized my two boys, the baptism right behind me. That was very, very special to me. But the big thing about Pop is he loved to laugh, and he loved to make people laugh. He liked comedians such as Steve Martin and Johnny Carson and Jonathan Winters. Jonathan Winters. It was funnier to watch my dad watch Jonathan Winters. I mean, this giggle would come out of him, and it wouldn't stop. And it was a lot more entertaining watching Pop. Watch him, but especially, you know, Steve Martin. Pop was one wild and crazy guy, you know. But in closing, I just want to say, you know, Pop's gone from this earth, but it's comforting to know that we'll meet again someday. Thank you all very much.
So I'm the oldest, as I'm sure most of you know, but I too thank you for coming today. So Pop was preceded in death also by two hernias and half a thumb, which wasn't mentioned earlier, so I'm sure he'll be happy to see that on the other side. You know, Pop I knew was very picky about his friends, and I'm really surprised to see most of you here. I figured it'd be, you know, just a handful of people, so. No, obviously I'm joking. You know, he never met a stranger, right? You always look back in your life, and sometimes when you have life lessons, you never really know that you're learning a lesson. And so I've spent a lot of time, you know, the last 2 weeks kind of reflecting back on that life and all the things that Pop taught me, and the things that you just don't realize at the time you're learning. So, you know, my last interaction with Pop, they had put him on a video, and he was laying on the couch, and I said, so how you feeling? And he kind of giggles, you know, and you knew Dad, you know, you knew it was coming because he would always have this kind of little giggle right before he'd do it. And he said, well, I don't know, never died before. And he started laughing, and then I started laughing, and that was the last words he said to me, you know, before he passed. And you know, and that's the way he would have wanted to go. And you know, I'm glad that that's my last memory of him. And so he was a very kind and gentle man, as you know. And again, he never met I don't think he ever met a stranger, and I've learned that from him in life as well. So. You know, tomorrow is Father's Day, right? You always, you know, that first year after, you kind of go through a bunch of firsts. But, you know, as my wife will tell you know, Father's Day to me, you know, you're a father every day, right? And I don't necessarily need a day every year to do that, you know. And Pop was a father to us every day. And so we didn't always need a holiday to do that. So, but we really, really appreciate him and all he's done and everything he's, you know, shared with us over our lives. So. Thank you again. I appreciate you coming today, and we love you, Pop.
Thank you all very much. Thank you very, very much. You know, sometimes in the busyness of things, we forget that life is a temporary assignment. Somebody once said, you know, it's too bad that dying is the last thing that we do because it could teach us so much about living. You know, facing the reality of death, I don't know, it does some things for us. You know, it's not usually when people die, it's not on their agenda, but the Bible says man is appointed once to die, and then after that, the judgment. And we all know that everybody's going to die. But it bothers us that we're not in control over how or when. And it just reminds us that we need to be ready. We really do need to be ready. But you know, it does several things for us. It reminds us the shortness of life. The book of James chapter 4 says that life is a vapor. And the more I have lost a lot of friends this year, some that I least expected to lose. I understand that. But you know what? These bodies that we have were never meant to live forever. When I was pastor at First Baptist of Hobbs, I used to visit this lady, Evelyn Rackham. She was a church secretary for, I think, right at 100 years. And she had two terminal diseases, but when I would go visit her in the hospital, she was always the one trying to encourage me, you know. And I remember the words that she said, they stuck with me. And I don't even remember how old she was. She said, Brother Bruce, she said, you know, these bodies, these little aches and pains that we feel as we grow older, she said, those are just God's gentle reminders that this body was not meant to live forever. And I thought, you know, she was right on. She was right on. But you know what it does? It helps us to evaluate. Sometimes when we go to the funeral service of somebody that we loved and had an incredible impact on our life, it helps us to kind of reevaluate. We stop and we reflect on things that otherwise we would not do. You know, Psalm 90 says, teach us to number our days which are to count our days. So I thought that was kind of an interesting verse in Psalm 90, but it also implies that we need to make our days count, which also implies that we need to know what counts. It kind of realigns, facing the reality of death kind of realigns our perspective on things. It reminds us of the temporariness of this life. 2 Corinthians 4 says, "We do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away. Our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing us for eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison." And that's cool. Well, you know, the Bible talks about a lot about death. Let me ask you a question. When you think about your life, and one day it's going to be your turn, and I hope that's a long time from now, but Dick Burnett had a lot of great days. He did. And a lot of my great days were with Dick Burnett. But let me ask you a question. What was your best day so far? What was your best day? If you reflect over your life, where you are right now, and you think, man, that's hard. What was your best day? I think about a lot of days. I remember the first time I asked this little girl to go on a date and wound up marrying with her. You know, I've been living with a married woman for almost 45 years. Well, that was a good day. And you know what? Dick Burnett had a lot of great days. I'm sure the first time he held Nancy's hand and his heart was just going, ah! And he had those boys, one and then another and then another, and then they found out what was causing all that. You know, really and truly, Dick had a lot of great days. But you need to know, Dick's best day was when he stepped out of this body that was not meant to live forever into the arms of a Savior that loved him and promised to care for him for all eternity. That was Dick Burnett's best day. You don't worry about Dick. Dick is fine. Probably better than he has ever been. But you know, the Bible tells us a lot about how to get ready for that day. The Bible gives us some words of comfort because we want to say something that will make a difference, that will kind of take away the hurt and take away the pain. And you know, our words just fall short. They just don't get it done. But you know, God's Word has the perfect thing for us today. In John 14, Jesus was talking to his disciples. He says, "Do not let your heart be troubled." Jesus was about to die. But he wasn't worried about himself. You know, when the Bible says he wept, when Jesus wept, that was when Lazarus had passed away. And his two sisters came running up to him and said, "Jesus, if you'd have been here, this wouldn't have happened." And, you know, Mary and Martha, and then the other one came up and said, "Jesus, if you would have been here, we sent for you." And he saw the hurt that they were going through for losing their brother. And it says Jesus wept. But, you know, just shortly after that, and people were saying, "Why did he wait so long?" You see, Mary and Martha knew that Jesus had the power to heal him. They knew that. So as soon as Lazarus was sick, they called for, "Let's get Jesus in here and he's going to fix this." And he didn't come. And they didn't understand. But then Jesus came. And then he did something that surprised them. You know, he says, "Roll the stone away." You know, and then that's always amazed me. You know, if he's going to raise him from the dead, couldn't he roll away the stone? Why wasn't that part of the show? You know what I'm saying? But they, you know, They do what they can do. God does what only God can do. They rolled away the stone, and he says, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus was raised that day. And it, because you see, Jesus allowed that. Because from that experience, they knew Jesus in a way that they did not know him before. They knew that he could heal, but now they knew him as the resurrection and the life. That he had not only power over nature, power over the demons, power over sickness, but over life itself. So they knew Jesus in a whole new way because of that experience. You know, it says, do not let your heart be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms, many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you will be where I am. That is where Dick is now. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That's what the scripture says. It says, you know the way to the place where I'm going. And Thomas looked at him and says, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And then Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And I'm going to be very brief. But you know, when we say we're celebrating the life of Dick Burnett, you know, we could tell stories and a lot of the great things that Dick Burnett did. And Dick was a joy in my life. I know he was in yours. And I'm going to miss that man. I really am. But I am going to see Dick Burnett again. I know that. But you know, see, God prepared. Through the scripture, we have faith in a person. He says, do not let your heart be troubled. Trust in me, he said. We have faith in a place. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it not were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. It's a prepared place. And we have faith in a promise. He says, and if I go, and he did, he said, to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me. That where I am, there you will be also. When we think about Dick Burnett and what we celebrate today, there's a reason for that. Now, Dick was a great guy. I mean, he may have had days, I don't know. Nancy could probably tell us some really interesting stories. We're not going to do that today. But Dick did a lot of great things. When I was in this church, years ago, I was called here as Minister of Education and Evangelism, and somewhere along the way, I acquired the youth position also, which was kind of interesting. And that's my wife calling me to tell me to turn my phone off, I bet. But there's, now where was I? There's things that Dick did in this church that people don't know about. You know, a lot of what Dick Burnett did was behind the scenes. And he was an encourager. And he loved people. And he would talk to people. And he would minister to people. And my mother was up at Carillon one time. And she tells a story when Dick Burnett came up there and visited her. My mother didn't even go to this church. But that was just Dick Burnett. And we could talk all day about what Dick Burnett did. But let me tell you, that's not what gives us hope today. Let me kind of wrap this up. I want you to know four truths in the scripture that make all the difference in the world today. The first truth is, you've heard it before, is you know that God loves you and has a plan for your life. Everybody and their dog has heard that, right? But it's even deeper than that. Did you know that God created you and your purpose for existing is not just to study, work, retire, and die? Did you know that God created you for His purposes, not for your purposes? That you were created, your reason for existing is to have a relationship with God Himself, not just for now, but for all eternity. That's why you were created. You were created to have a relationship with the God of this universe. That's why you exist. That's why you were created. God created you, and there's only one of you. Somebody was saying, yeah, you're one of a kind. You're unique. Nobody's got your thumbprint. You're somebody special. There's only one of you. You're unique. You're one of a kind, just like everybody else. But you are. You were created by God, and the reason you exist is to have a relationship with God. That's why you were created. Second truth, we have a really big problem. That problem is that we have what the Bible calls sin. Now, whatever the name, you know what it is. We know what's right and we do what's wrong. All of us, the Bible says, have things in our life that are not pleasing to God. And that you know that God says sin will not enter into heaven? Well, you know, that kind of creates a problem because we're all really good at this sin thing. You know, some of our sins are pretty well hidden, but they're there. And you know what's worse is that, you know, once you sin, you can't unsin. Did you know that? You cannot unthink a thought. You can't unring a bell. You cannot undo those things we have done. And can you imagine if you went up to heaven and people were cussing and lying and stealing, and he said it won't be that way because God does not allow sin into heaven. And that is a problem because you and I have a serious problem, and that's called sin. We have envy, jealousy, hatred, things that we've done, things that we've left undone. Did you know that James 4:17, it says, he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. It's not just sin doing bad things, but not doing what you do know that's good. So the problem is, guys, is that we have got our masters in the area of sin. And there's not anything we can do to unsin. And that creates a huge problem. Okay, now that brings us to the third truth. The first one is you were created to have a relationship with God. That's why you exist. The second thing is we have a huge sin problem. But now the third truth is that God did something for you and I that we could not do for ourselves. He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to be born in a manger, lived here 33 years. He walked on the water. He healed people. He cured things, cast out demons, did all kinds of incredible things. But the last thing He did on this earth was He died on a cross. Now, everybody knows He died on a cross. Not really sure why He did it, but the Bible says the wages of sin is death. That means when He died on that cross, He paid once and for all the price for my sin and your sin. Now that's a big deal. He did something for you and I that we could not do for ourselves. But now it all comes down to this fourth truth. And that's why we're going to find out why we have joy today. Because it's not enough to know those first three. It's not enough to know that you were created to have a relationship with God. It's not enough to know that you, my friend, have a serious sin problem that you cannot fix yourself. It's not enough to know that Jesus came and died on a cross to pay for your sin and even believe those right things about that. Because, you know, when I grew up in church, I was one of those kids that I was in church 9 months before I was born. You know, I was spoon-fed Jesus. I believed all the right things. And I believed with all my heart that Jesus was the Son of God. He died on a cross, rose again. He's coming back. Everything the Bible says, I believed it. But you know what? Please hear what I'm saying. Knowing those things did not make any change in my life. Until one time this girl started talking to me, and she was going through these same truths that you're hearing today. And when she got to this part, she pulled out a verse that just knocked my socks off. And that's James 2:19. It says, you believe in God? That's great. The demons also believe and tremble. And I said, say what? And for the first time, it dawned on me that it is not enough just to know the facts about Jesus and believe that he's the Son of God. The demons know that he's the Son of God, that he born in a manger and died on a cross and rose again, because it's not enough to believe just the right things about Jesus. Please hear what I'm going to say here. The Bible gives us a definition of eternal life, John 17:3, and it says, this is eternal life, to know God and his Son, Jesus Christ. Because you see, you can believe all the right things about Jesus Christ and not know him. For example, you can believe with all your heart that a lifeboat can save you, and you can drown believing that. Say what? Yes, you can. Because it's not believing that a lifeboat can save you that saves you. It's getting in the boat that saves you. It is not your faith that saves you. It is the lifeboat that saves you. See, faith is what's called a transitive verb. You have faith in something. By faith, you get in the boat, but it's the boat that does the saving. By faith, you trust Christ, but it's not your faith that does the saving. It's Jesus that does the saving. I hope you're getting this, because this is a big deal. Because, my friend, I have a peace in my heart for Dick Burnett. We've had a lot of conversations, and he shared with me about knowing Jesus Christ. And I believe with all my heart that Dick's main concern right now is for you. Because you see, one day it'll be your turn. And we'll all be gathered around here. And the only thing that's going to matter on that day, it's not going to matter how many diplomas you have on the wall. It's not going to matter what kind of a house you live in. It's not going to matter what kind of a job you had. The only thing that's going to matter on that day is if you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. That's it. We are celebrating today the life of Dick Burnett. Not because he was a great guy. Yeah, he was a great guy. But because, not just all the stories about Dick, but that story about Jesus Christ that Dick believed with all his heart. Because, see, Dick knew the story, but there was a day when Dick got in the boat. Let me tell you how you do that. If you're here today and maybe you know the reality of your death is coming like a freight train and you're terrified, let me tell you what to do. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. You can just say this prayer. You can say, God, I know that I'm a sinner. And I know I can't save myself. And I know that you died on that cross for me. And I know there's not anything I can do to undo the sin in my life. And I know you died to make me right with you. And God, I want to trust you right now. I want you to come into my heart and forgive me of my sins, and I want to follow you as my Lord and my Savior. Wow, isn't that simple? God made it so simple that even a child could be saved. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we do celebrate Dick Burnett. God, I'm going to miss him so much. But God, I'm so thankful that Dick came to that point in his life where he trusted you as his Lord and Savior. And Father, because of that, Father, I know I'm going to see my mom and my dad and a lot of people again, but Father, the main thing I want to see is I want to see Jesus. Because, you know, That's really, in this life, the only thing that really matters. And God, as we go through these coming days and we think about the stories and we think about Dick Burnett, we'll also think about the story of a Savior that died for us. And because of that saving act, we have hope. And that's very, very real, especially today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We have another song. I want to thank you for being here today, and if you didn't sign the book, I wish you would, either on your way out. And at this time, we're going to dismiss by rows the folks, and then the family will have some time together.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue, clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, also on the faces of people going by. I see friends.
much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Thank you.